We have a group photo taking place over here. That's okay. Troublemakers again, all right. Hello, welcome to the 8th Annual Design in 7. I'm Becky Yust, Interim Dean of the College of Design, and I want to thank you for joining us this evening. You're in for a terrific night. We will be hearing from 7 professionals eager to share their stories with you, and especially the students in the audience. The award-winning annual program is presented by our Design Student and Alumni Board, or DSAB. Never learned how to say that in one word. That's a group of alumni, students, and professionals representing each of the College of Design disciplines. DSAB members work to create programs and opportunities that support the student transition from college to career, connecting alumni, students, and industry professionals in the process. I'd like to take a moment to thank the board members for their work in putting this event together. And if we could just raise the house lights a little bit. If you're a current board member or one of our past DSAB presidents, just please stand for a moment to be recognized. Thank you so much for your leadership. In addition to Design in 7 and a variety of college to career programs, the DSAB board also supports the Design Mentor Program, which matches over 200 graduate and undergraduate students with mentors each year. We have a large group of mentors and students in the audience tonight who are wrapping up the mentoring experience for the year. And we thank those who participated, both students and mentors, but we want to share a special thanks to the mentors who gave their time to support our students. So if you have been a mentor this year, could you just please stand briefly so you can be recognized? Wow, thank you. Okay, just gonna get a little exercise before the program starts. In addition, this event, as well as the mentor program and many other programs, would not be possible without the help of this year's College to Career program sponsors. I want to thank them, and as I name our sponsors, if you are present and represent one of the firms I'm going to name, please stand and remain standing until all are named. So they are Gardner Builders, Hayworth, Made for Retail, one of our speakers is here, right? Wold, Damon Farber, HGA, and Studio Hive. So if you can stand, thank you. Thank you. Their generosity has helped to support over 20 programs and activities this academic year alone. But I would also be remiss if I did not mention we're currently looking for sponsors for 2017-2018. And if your firm is interested in supporting the development of our current and future professionals, we'd love to talk to you. So the contact information for the office is in your card deck, so please contact them to learn more. One final bit of recognition. When you arrived this evening, you received a pack of trading cards featuring each of our speakers. Every year, a design student illustrates our cards, and it's always a fun surprise to see the finished work. This year, Justine Nussbaum, so Justine, stand up. Justine created the illustrations. Justine is a senior in our graphic design program, and thank you so much for your excellent work. These are always so fun. Thank you again. Now, I'd like to turn the mic over to our guest MC for the evening, Brad Holshue. Brad's a faculty member and co-director of the Wearable Technology Lab in the College of Design. You might also recognize him as one of our Design in 7 speakers from last year. If you didn't make it to the show last year, you didn't get one of his cards. So this is special card. I still am saving, Brad. It's terrific. But you can see his video on the Design in 7 website and find out what happens when an MIT engineer turns his attention to apparel design. With that, please welcome our MC, Brad Holshue.
Thank you, Becky. Before we get started, I'd like to give a round of applause to Becky herself. She has served as interim dean for a few years now, but some of you may have heard our college has recently announced the hiring of our future dean. So I think this is a perfect opportunity now that we recognize Becky for her leadership in the college. So, welcome to the 8th Annual Design in 7. As Becky mentioned, I had the privilege of speaking at this event last year. And for those of you that were there, you may have seen me speak, but you may also have noticed that the MC for last year's show was a professional comedian, Andy Erickson. So when they asked me to MC the show this year, I said, what are they thinking? I'm not a comedian. And I had kind of this moment of trying to understand, okay, what does it mean to MC this show? It can go one of two ways. One, maybe they're trying to signal that they want this to have more of an academic flavor. So they're bringing me in as the dry professor to beat the academic. The other possibility that I thought of is maybe, just maybe, this is a signal from someone up the food chain, maybe Becky, that I should be reconsidering my career as an academic and maybe comedy is where I should be going. Now, my wife and kids are certainly sick of the jokes that I make, and my grad students are even more sick of the jokes that I make, so I'm not going to subject you to them. I'm going to let the show be our speakers where it should be. So, you all understand the Design in 7 program brings professionals from across the design industry to share their experience, share their stories, share their wisdom in 7 minutes or less. So this is a TED Talk style event. It's really exciting, the group that we have here in front of us, because they represent the diversity of disciplines that we represent here in our college. You're going to hear speakers talk from an architecture perspective, apparel and product design, graphic design, interior design, housing, retail merchandising, landscape architecture. All of the domains that we talk about here in our college, you're going to see representation from tonight, and that's really exciting. Not only that, many of the speakers that you're going to see tonight are alumni of the U. So this is going to be a really great exposure of what life can look like if you come from a design perspective from our institution and go out into the world. The stories that you're going to hear are going to touch on many different themes. Design and creativity, entrepreneurship, inspiration, invention, sometimes reinvention. Learning what it's like to reinvent yourself, what it means to be in the world of design, to go through the trenches, and to come out unscathed. You're going to hear some really impressive stories tonight, and I'm excited for you to get to meet our speakers. So with that, we're going to turn it over to our first speaker, who I have the privilege to introduce. Kate Arends, founder and creative director of Wit and Delight. Kate is a St. Paul-based creative and multi-channel marketing consultant with extensive experience in the design industry. In addition to running Wit and Delight, a lifestyle media company, Kate creates strategic design, marketing, and product solutions for brands including Target, 3M, Fossil, and Red Wing Heritage. Her design work has been published in AIGA 365, Communication Arts, and Print Magazine. So with that, let's welcome Kate to the stage.
It is fitting that I am here tonight to talk to you all about reinvention. The question that I have been asked the most in my entire design career is, tell me again, what is it exactly you do? What is it that you do? People tend to emphasize the whole doing part a lot. And the reality is that I think all of us know that the work matters, but it's a lot more about the process. Because when you get excited about your client's problems, you have the ability to use any medium that you need to solve it. What we know about reinvention and what our design training tells us is reinventing is not necessarily about throwing out the rule book and starting something new. We know that it is about a series of moments, a series of pivots, where we need to consider what should happen next. We have the benefit of objectivity, we have the benefit of experience, and we have the benefit of understanding exactly how someone can build on top of what they've already established. So, why is it so hard for us to do that for ourselves? Just like any brand, all of us have a lifespan to our career. We're gonna do a lot of things, we're gonna wear a lot of hats. The reason why I think it's so hard for us to sometimes turn the lens on ourselves and consider how we need to evolve is because it's hard to do. And when you don't have the benefit of objectivity, it becomes very complicated to figure out what's next. What it felt for me like when I had to figure out how to pivot is it felt like I was in a dark room and I couldn't find the light switch. I was just sort of like, what do I do? I don't know what I should do. And that is so different than what we do for a living when we solve problems. So I'm gonna tell you my story through my series of pivots about how I went from designer to running this thing that people still ask me, what is it again that you do? So I started Wit and Delight when I learned to embrace fear. This entire website was born out of just utter fear of what was going to happen to me next. It was 2008, the economy had just crashed, and I didn't have a lot, but I had a lot of debt and not a lot of money in my bank account. And I kept thinking, I worked for this great small company, it's wonderful to be here, but I mean, what am I gonna do if this goes away? So what I did, I'm gonna make sure I just do this here. What I did was I said, okay, I'm going to run towards fear. I'm gonna look at things that I have, things that I can do with what little I do have and say, okay, what can I do to control my destiny? So I started a website that was really designed to bring the specific type of clients to me versus hiding in bed and wishing that they'll come to me, and decided that I would just sort of put myself out there. Social media was becoming a thing, and I thought, why not give it a try? The next pivot I made was betting on my own grit, on my own work ethic. And that really had everything to do with the fact that I had no idea how to build a website. I was a print designer, I did packaging, and I didn't know how to code. And mind you, this is way before there was very elegant Squarespace pages. I'm gonna date myself and say, back when I was a designer, it was so hard. But we didn't have a lot of that stuff. So I had to go all night long, and I had to learn how to code myself. The site was horrendous, but what it did was, I created a different layout from what most blogs did, and it was all about browsing content versus scrolling. The site may have sucked, but it got people to stop and consider what I was saying. And I would say that that meant that I worked hard enough to get to the next phase. The next thing I had to do was learn how to ignore everyone, especially critics. And critics are good, but what happens sometimes when you're doing something new is people don't get it, and oftentimes they tend to look at their own work and then give you opinions on it based on what they might be feeling afraid or insecure about. And a lot of times, critics give you really, really, really valuable information. You don't have to listen to everyone, and that's the most important thing to remember when you're getting critiqued, because sometimes the road least traveled has fewer but better friends, because the people who believe in your vision, even if they don't get it and they believe in you, you're gonna be fine, and you wanna keep those people around. This is where I'm at today. I'm at my next pivot, and this is learning to let go. And I'm learning to let go of the fact that if I looked at my life from where I was 10 years ago when I graduated college, I would have said, oh, you're not a creative director, and you're not designing packages, and you're not working at a big firm. She would have been disappointed. And I've had to learn to let go of the fact that when I left my advertising job, my design job, people said, are you crazy? How are you gonna get back into this? What's your backup plan? And I just went for it. So I've decided to focus on what I do have. And what that's done for me is it's kept me motivated. In 2014, I wanted to quit Wit and Delight. It had become this lifestyle blog, and I had become, frankly, a little disenfranchised with how beautiful everything looked all the time. I had felt that there wasn't much substance, and I was going through a lot in my personal life, and so I said, okay, if lifestyle is about caring for people, maybe it's about caring for yourself. And so I just threw some content up there that said, okay, you know, I'm struggling through this. I've learned how to like myself a little bit more by accepting the fact that I have some depression and anxiety, and I have ADD. And let's just see where this goes with Wit and Delight. And the response was great. We were not only helping people live a life that was a little bit more interesting and fun, we were also helping them solve problems that were getting in the way of their work. And the work that I do today, I still work with clients, and that sort of feeling of having a purpose is starting to come through in the work that I'm doing. It's starting to come through in the way that I art direct. It's starting to come through with the clients that I select. We're getting more and more about focusing on making people care about the message itself. So today we have 3.1 million people that follow us. We've got 4 full-time contractors and 8 paid writers. We're working on 5 product lines right now, which is why I have bags under my eyes and I have not slept. And we're launching events in studio space in May of 2017. And the thing that I want you guys to remember is, if you feel like you don't know where the light switch is, if you don't know what's happening next, you're on the precipice of something really, really good. That's how you're supposed to feel. Follow it. And just, Wit and Delight was born out of fear. And that's, I think, the most important thing to remember about what's next for you. Thank you.